Anyways, two corporate voice. Lower crude prices, cheaper pet coke are all good news for cement makers in the country. But what's not as encouraging is the flattish prices, with manufacturers failing to gain back any meaningful pricing power. Will this change anytime soon? I spoke to Bina Engineer of Sanghi Cement and began by asking her about her views on the recent price hikes in the cement space.
It's a very small marginal hike in the price, which I would consider more as a routine. And it is expected during this season, when the volume improves, there is some possibility of price hike for the cement players. Also, as you pointed out, the cost hikes could not have been passed off to the consumer during last quarter. So marginal impact of that also is on the price.
So in the recent NBFC turmoil and the general tight liquidity situations, have you been adequately funded? I know you're tied up your funding, but has funding been adequate for you to continue your expansion plans as previously planned? Would you be on track with the entire expansion process?
Absolutely. There is no impact of this liquidity crisis on our expansion plan. We have all committed about 40% funds into the project. So I would say we have invested around 40% into various letters of credit and advance payments, etc., to the suppliers. And we are very much on track.
Okay. Have costs, finance costs gone up, Ms. Engineer?
Marginally, yes, because MCLR across the entire finance scenario has gone up, so at least 25 to 50 bips point is the increment everyone has seen. And these are all tied on MCLR basis, so there has been a small impact of that.
Okay. Now, you know, I just want to dwell a little bit on costs, Ms. Engineer. For Sanghi in particular, and if quarter one and quarter two in particular are an indication, costs are proving to be a bit of a headache. You have the lowest raw material cost per ton, but freight and power and fuel are just looking abnormally high. I mean, our calculations seem to suggest that that's been the big bugbear for you. How does the situation shape up over the course of the next couple of quarters, but more importantly, over the long term? You are regarded as the company with the best limestone reserves and therefore the lowest cost, but it is to no avail if indeed the other costs are pooping the party so badly.
You are right that last two quarters, power, fuel and the freight costs have been significantly on the higher side. Fortunately, the worst is over. We had two, three issues during last two quarters. One of them was obviously the diesel price hike, which has softened during last about, say, 1 month, and softened significantly. Besides the fact that new axle load policy has been now implemented, and that is allowing us to carry higher load per truck, and therefore the freight cost is likely to soften during the second half of the year. So that addresses the freight issue, which had gone through the roof during last half year. That should soften significantly. Second is the power fuel. So we have been major user of lignite, and we were using 3/4 of lignite as our fuel mix, both for the power plant as well as for the kiln. During last 6 months, that changed significantly to, say, just about 10 to 15% lignite availability. On the other hand, the coal cost had gone up very high in international markets, coupled with the rupee depreciation. Now, if you see, during last about 1 month, all of these factors have corrected. Coal prices have come down by about 8 to 10%. Rupee has strengthened by, let's say, at least about 5 to 6%. And the lignite availability has improved from what we were using to, say, from 15% to at least around 30-35%. So all these three factors have corrected in our favor during last about one and a half months. So I'm looking forward to a better power, fuel and freight numbers during this quarter. Having said that, despite all of these, we continue to remain the cost leader in the industry even during the last quarter.
On the raw material cost, I agree, but otherwise our calculations seem to suggest that you slipped the ranks a little bit. Please correct me if I'm wrong there. And part two of my question, therefore, would be based on the answer that you just gave me. As a calculation, I think freight and power and fuel accounted for about 78% of your total costs. Does that change materially in quarter three, quarter four?
It would. It would, because of the factors which I just described. It had eaten up into our margins during first half, which would now get released, and we should improve on that during the second half.
So about from 22.5%, which were reasonably good EBITDA margins, to about 13.5% that you fell to in quarter two, give or take a few percentage points here and then, depending on what you include and what you don't, you reckon a 300, 400 basis points improvement or maybe even more is a distinct possibility?
Yes, during the period from now to March, yes. Maybe this quarter will not reflect as much because all of these changes are happening as we speak. And therefore, the whole of this quarter may not reflect all these advantages. But clearly, by end of March, we should have all these advantages in place.
Okay. Ms. Engineer, just a slightly long-term question. When you announce your expansion plans and your intend to move into the Mumbai region, etc., and the coastal shipping, I think that's what got a few people a bit excited and a bit concerned. With concern because, companies owning large assets, ships, etc., for example, is not maybe the most ideal cost scenario. But in your case, it would help you because you would transform your cost, your freight cost materially as a result of this use. What's the long-term proportion of freight costs that you envisage for you as a company? I'm just trying to get a sense of whether Sanghi becomes a material cost leader on the production side, and by production I mean not just the raw material cost but freight and fuel and costs as well, over the next 3 or 4 years, because you have the raw material cost advantage. What happens to the other factors over the long term?
See, you are right that we are an asset heavy company because we have taken all the assets in this balance sheet, and we don't have any subsidiaries or associate and related companies in which we hold the asset and we bill out to this company. And therefore, whatever the advantage of that ownership model versus a rental model is to accrue, that accrues directly to this company, which actually is a positive for the stakeholders. Second thing is that while the shipping has a positive impact on the freight, more importantly, it opens the new geography for us and it gives us a larger and wider market of Mumbai and the surrounding regions, which was very critical for our growth. And therefore, the move into the coastal shipping, we expect that over a period of time, at least around 20-25% of our material would be shipped out, and which will have the positive impact on the freight cost. As I mentioned, lignite or imported coal, the scenario is now stabilizing. The freight and the crude oil scenario are also stabilizing. So I do see that Sanghi will continue to maintain the cost leadership that we have enjoyed during last couple of years also, and in coming 3 to 4 years.
Okay, my final question, Ms. Engineer, and that would be, a 3-year timeline or a 4-year timeline, when you have all your capacities running on stream, you probably have your shipping routes sorted and 25% of your material moving through ships, and therefore that cost advantage coming in as well. What happens to the debt picture? That is one concern, right? You are indebted. Maybe you had to take it because you had these expansion plans. Promoter holding is pledged quite significantly. The last I heard was 97%. It may have changed a little bit here and there. How does all of that shape up over the medium term?
First, let me address the promoter pledge. This was asked to me by various analysts also. So I need to clarify that the promoter holding is not pledged to 97%, but promoters have given non-divestment undertaking that they will not dilute below 51% shareholding in the company. And that kind of undertaking is now considered as an encumberment as per the new SEBI guideline, and accordingly we have to make those disclosures to stock exchanges and etc. Therefore, it appears to have been encumbered, but it is not a pledge, it is non-divestment, which is again a positive for the company and the rest of the stakeholders, that promoters are undertaking not to divest below 51% during this project period and beyond. So that's the clarification. It's not 97%. One can access our shareholding pattern, and the notes are given in the shareholding pattern disclosed on the stock exchange websites.
The other one was
that
debt.
That answers your second question. And
the debt, yeah. The first question was about debt.
The other one was on the debt, and there, correct. Correct. So the we are not into major repayment of debt this, till this project is completed. That is till about March 20. After March 20, once the project is commissioned, we will have far enhanced cash flows, and we are till then we are conserving the cash. After that, our repayments will continue, and we have a very long date. We have almost time for total of about another 9 years after 20. So we have repayment schedules stretching up to 2029. So therefore, I don't see any significant pressure on the cash flows with respect to the debt. At any given point in time, my debt equity ratio will not exceed 1. So that also we have ensured that we are in the fairly strong balance sheet mode.